Why are you stuck in the cycle of back pain? Why do people get stuck in the cycle of back pain? This is such a bigger question than what should I do for my exercise? How do I get better? The path to getting better is there. It's strengthening your core. It's building endurance in the core musculature to be able to support your spine throughout your day, not just during exercise, but during the time that you're sitting and during the time that you're standing and walking and waiting in line and moving, doing house chores. These are the times when we are either wearing down or breaking down these tissues, or we're doing them in a healthy way, so we're actually building them up. Let's just assume a disc has become damaged for whatever reason. It could be a gradual onset, it could be a car accident, it could be the way that you moved and twisted your body when you were lifting some object, and you're in this situation where a disc got damaged. And we need this tissue to heal, right? So what do we do when we want a tissue to heal, a soft tissue? We rest it. We avoid using it because, well, if you use an injured tissue, say you tore your knee and you continued to play basketball and use your knee, that tissue is not going to heal as well as it could, right? Immobilized, it needs to be stabilized, maybe by a cast or a brace, and you need to rest it and let it heal. So that's what we do with our discs, with our back. Our discs are kind of abstract to us. We can't see them or really feel them from the outside. So we're resting our entire back. We rest our core. And when we rest our back and our core, what happens to the other tissues? We have muscles, we have tendons, we have ligaments, we have tons of soft tissues around our core. And if you're not using them naturally because they're biological tissues, they become weaker. If you don't use it, you lose it. When we are resting our discs so that they can heal, our muscles around our core become weaker, which are the very things that stabilize and brace the discs, right? This is the knee brace, essentially, is our core muscles. We're trying to rest an injury, but we're actually making the injury worse at the same time because we're losing the ability to protect the injury. All right, so now we've gone through this period of rest, and it's time to start using our body again, but the core muscles, the support for our spine, is not quite strong enough to stabilize the spine for certain movements. And so maybe it's not an everyday thing, but maybe once a week you do a movement, you reach for something, or you close a window or open a window or lift an object, and something tweaks. And that is an impulsive movement. It's a large amplitude movement, or a movement that's just a little higher intensity than your normal day to day. And that's going to do what? It's going to break that down the tissue a little more because you didn't have the protection to support the disc, to support the spine, to brace the disc with this internal brace that we've been given in our anatomy. And so this is part of the cycle, right? And so we have a little setback, we're back in rest mode, we're back in protect the back by not using it, and then the soft tissues become even weaker still. And so this is the cycle of back pain. And then eventually, if it goes on for months, potentially years, it becomes a psychological injury as well. So we avoid using our back. We avoid participating in certain life events. We avoid activities. And this downward spiral, it becomes the way of life. How do we get out of this downward spiral of back pain? You actually have to go towards your injury. You actually have to strengthen the very tissues that you feel like you should not be using right now. And there's fear associated with that, because if you use them too much, if you strengthen them too much, you actually can get a setback. You can actually injure them in the process of trying to strengthen them by doing exercise. And so that probably happens to us here and there. We realize that we need to get stronger. Oh my gosh, I'm very weak. I need to go to the gym. You do some form of exercise and you get incredibly sore and set yourself back a few weeks. And so you're like, I can't exercise anymore because every time I exercise, I hurt myself. This is the problem that keeps us in the spiral, in the cycle of back pain. We have to go towards that thing, that very thing that scares us. it's not whether you should exercise or not, because that's on or off. That's like a light switch. And if you look at exercise as a light switch, either exercise or don't exercise, then you're either doing it too extreme or you're not doing it at all. And either of those are bad for you. You cannot do 100% and you cannot do 0%. Both of those will make your problem worse. And what we need to do is we need to operate in the gray area, in the middle of 100% or 0%. And we need to do low intensity, gradual progression of strength training so that we are able to strengthen the tissues that are weaker. We are able to strengthen the core muscles that we need to support our spine without compromising the injury. And this is what I like to call the 1% rule. We just need to challenge our tissues 1% more than they are capable of. And it's not enough intensity to tear or further injure tissues, but it is enough intensity to actually strengthen the muscles a little bit, actually give you a little more support in your future. And then you can build on that, because when you're stronger a couple days later, you can then do another 1% increase in the challenge of yourself of through exercise. And so you need to do exercise, but you need to do it at a lower intensity so that you're not setting yourself back. And all of this involves going towards the injury, using the very tissues that are injured, because they are the ones that need to get stronger so that you can then in your future life, your future self, you can get back to using your body again. The way to never get back to full use of your body again is to avoid doing the activities that caused your injury in the first place. If you avoid doing the activities that injured you in the first place, then you will never be able to do those activities again. Even if they're good, healthy activities, even if it's something like doing a deadlift or doing your favorite activity or throwing something in a certain way, that is the thing that you need to be going towards. And not 100%. It's not like you can just jump in and start playing basketball again, you know, on a random day. You need to be going through the motions in a controlled manner, maybe even under supervision, maybe with a physical therapist. It doesn't matter if you are with a physical therapist or not. It's actually can become a big hurdle when you go to physical therapy and they're guiding you through this entire process, and then you get discharged and you stop. And then you're like, now, what do I do? At some point, you're going to have to take it into your own hands and start doing modified versions of the things that you fear doing, and getting and gradually and slowly building up your strength to be able to do those things again in a calculated way, in a mindful way. So for example, say I injured myself lifting a box, a heavy box, I would probably consider, after doing some initial therapy on my core to strengthen those tissues, I would probably practice that lifting motion, but with no weight at all, just body weight. Body weight deadlifts, what I call a hip hinge. You have to practice and go towards the hip hinge in order to ever recover from the injury. And you have to be able to hip hinge to function in life. You can't do the hip hinge. Is it on and off? When you do the hip hinge, it hurts you, so you don't do it at all. Either do it fully or don't do it at all. We don't do on or off. We don't do extremes. We work in that magic gray area. So how can we modify the hip hinge in a way that allows us to do it and go towards the injury and towards the fear, but not actually injure ourselves? So it's not the full hip hinge. It's not 100%, but it's the gray area of maybe that was only a 5% hip hinge, but at least I'm doing it and I'm going towards it. And I'm using my fingertips on the stool to help me and help to reduce or even eliminate my fear, because I'm confident doing it within that tiny, tiny range. But it's when I go a couple inches further that my fear kicks in, because I know that's the range where I might injure myself. So I go right up to that edge and I get super confident in that range. That confidence will spill over a little bit. There's no debate about this. When you exercise tissues within a range, say you go from 45 to 90 degrees, there is spillover in your training where those actual muscles will get strengthened about 10 degrees on either side of that range. So you're training 45 to 90 degrees of range of motion, but your strengthening goes from 35 degrees to 100 degrees. And so you actually gain a little bit of strength in that range that you were afraid of training. And all of this is working towards going towards the injury, improving your functional abilities, strengthening your tissues, quelling your fear, which is a major part of the injury. And then maybe a week later, you can do a tiny bit more range. Once I feel confident that with that, I would go to another, a slightly more challenging thing, maybe just lifting a super light weight, and gradually over a period of weeks and months, and maybe even longer, build myself back up to being able to lift that very box that injured me, but confidently, and then get past that and be able to lift an even heavier box, but confidently. And that is how you are going to strengthen the injured tissues and all the support tissues around it to the point where you can live your full functional life without injuring yourself. And that psychological aspect to the injury, the fear of movement, the fear avoidance behavior becomes conquered. For the SI joint, there are things that you should avoid early in your healing process, but in the long timeline of recovering from SI joint pain, you have to reintroduce those things that stress the SI joint in a calculated way, in a progressive, gradual way, so you can strengthen the tissues in a way that can withstand those stresses in the future. So, for example, we have ligaments that hold our SI joint together. And maybe you've become very strong in stabilizing these ligaments with horizontal forces because you've been doing the bridge or you've been doing this or that that's getting you there. But maybe these tissues, these fibers are not strong being pulled in this direction or in this direction. And so you got to start gradually working on changing your angles, changing the way that you stress these tissues, because even a ligament, even it's not a muscle, right? It's a ligament. So we don't have control over ligaments to contract them or lift weights with ligaments. They're just like ropes in our body, but they're biological ropes and they can still get stronger. And the only way they get stronger is by stressing them. That's also the way that they get injured. And so it's this fine balance. It's this gray area. It's the magic zone that you need to work in, this area where you're stressing them to the point where they get stronger, but not stressing them too much to the point where they actually tear. And the other end of the zone is not stressing them enough. If you're not stressing them enough, then they get weaker. And so stressing a ligament just means putting tension in it, pulling on it through forces. So calculated forces could even be 4% increase in the amount of strain that you're pulling through the ligament. That's not enough to tear the tissue. But if you are not doing this process and you're just going through your daily life trying to avoid injuring these tissues, doing fear avoidance behavior, avoiding certain movements, the day that comes in your life when you actually have to do that movement because something fell into your lap or you had to react to something and get out of the way of something, that impulsive movement is likely going to be the thing that injures it and sets you back because it didn't have that resilience to withstand that impulsive force that you've been trying to avoid for months and potentially years and keeping yourself vulnerable to injury. So the way that we give ourselves full function again is by going towards the injury. Work on the activity that you fear in a modified, controlled, calculated, and mindful way. Tune into your body, going through that motion in slow motion. And ultimately, if you can increase your ability by 1% per week over a period of 100 weeks, you have 100% improvement. And I believe in a long enough timeline, that is a very, very possible goal. You could actually shoot for 1% per day with core muscles, because core muscles actually strengthen much faster than some of the big muscles and tissues in your body, like your quads or your biceps. Core muscles are designed to recover and strengthen very quickly. And so you could go for 1% improvement per day, and in 100 days, you could have a life-changing change in your functional abilities. If you believe that there are days that you can get better, have a better day than the day before, that is related to something you did. Like you had a perfect day for your back. You did the exercises that made you feel the best, and you avoided the things that are hurting you. And you did that for a full day, had a perfect day, and the next day you felt better. You felt better because of something that you did. You had control over that. If you believe that's possible for you, then I 100% believe that you could have another day that's better than that day before it. So you can build off of better days because it's under your control. And you could have potentially two perfect days in a row and three. And that's the journey of climbing out of the spiral. And maybe there's a little setback in there and you get back up and you do it again. And so if we have to go towards that thing, that very thing that scares us in a gradual, progressive, calculated way. And we have to go towards our fear. And you will learn that if you do this in the right way, in a mindful way, there is function and ability and increased activities and increased participation in life on the other side of that fear when you have strengthened your body and built resilience. Be patient with it. Be okay with 1% improvements and 1% increases in challenge, because on a long enough timeline, that is just the blink of an eye to a life where you have your body back and you have ability back and you have confidence back, and it's totally worth it. So it's not black or white. It's not on or off. It's not 0% or 100%. It's somewhere in that magic zone in the middle, in that gray area where you're listening to your body, you're moving deliberately, and you're going towards the fear that you've been avoiding, which has been keeping you in that cycle of back pain. It's time to start climbing out of it. So thank you, everyone. And with that said, I'm going to sign off. I'll be back next week. And until then, get down on the floor and connect to your core.